Hello and welcome to SciJoy. So Tim, what are we going to be learning today?
Well, today we're going to learn how to troubleshoot your electronics project. Before we learn about some basic testing methodology and troubleshooting techniques, let's learn about some terms. So Jacqueline, what is an open circuit?
So an open in your circuit is a gap where electricity can't flow through. Sometimes we do this intentionally, like with a light switch. The gap in the circuit turns off your light. And sometimes this is unintentional, like when I'm soldering and I don't make a good solder joint, and electricity can't flow from one component to the next. So Tim, do you want to tell us about shorts in our circuits?
Sure. So a short circuit is really a shortcut, if you can think of it as a way that electricity would route around where you intended it to go. Let's look at an example. Here we have an LED with multiple resistors for input. When we touch the legs of the resistors together, the resistance value changes. This causes the LED to change color. If you have an LED in a circuit and you accidentally short one of the resistors, you can cause the voltage value across the LED to increase beyond its capable limit, causing it to explode. So now we've learned about some basic terms, let's talk about some testing. So Jacqueline, what should we look at when we test?
So we're going to start out with a few simple ones, and as we get further in the video, we'll talk about more complex ones, and we'll start with how to find opens in your circuit using continuity testing. To do our testing, we're going to use a digital multimeter. You change your setting to the resistance setting, and then you hit select twice to go to the audible tone, and that will tell you that your circuit is completed. So that sound tells us that we don't have any opens in that segment of our circuit, and the electricity is going from one end of the wire to the other.
You should have no electricity flowing between wires when you have an isolation. Here we have a twisted pair where the insulation has been stripped and the two wires are connected. This would fail an isolation test.
You don't want to just test your project at the end. There could be a lot of problems that you'd have to troubleshoot, so you want to do it along the way. When we were putting stuff in the space shuttle, every section that we put in, we would do some tests to make sure that nothing was wrong with it. And then at the very end of our project, we would do an overall functional test. So we're going to take you step by step through our process of building the ramp and some troubleshooting we did along the way.
Now let's talk about diagramming and labeling. For our projects, we like to take a spreadsheet, label the inputs, the outputs, and then what type of wire we're connecting it to, or maybe a sensor on the other end.
So we use the color coding scheme on the back of the patch panel and then the patch connectors to route our Ethernet. And then we labeled our wires with red, green, and yellow tape so we would know what was power, ground, and signal. And I also made a wiring chart so we would know what plugged into which connector.
Here we got a patch panel which has numbers on the back, and we use this in conjunction with the inputs and outputs on our Arduino project for a ramp. After we soldered our signal wires to our PCB, we made sure that the wires were isolated from each other using the continuity test on our digital multimeter. We soldered all of our grounds together. We checked for continuity along the way to make sure that none of our wires were missed in the soldering. Sometimes you do a lot of extra work before you realize there's a simpler way. In this case, we could have just connected them with a screw. We also need to make sure that everything is turned on and plugged in. This is often one of the most overlooked but simplest methods of troubleshooting.
After we made sure that our power was on to our sensors, we had some erratic readings. And as you know, we should turn on a pull-up or a pull-down resistor. We checked our code, and that was working. And we wanted to know why we were still having floating voltages. And that's because we didn't have a common reference ground between our Arduino and our power supply. After we wired the back of the patch panel, we made sure all the grounds were together and all the power was together. And we did this by doing a continuity check, and we would swipe across the pins on the front.
We were fortunate enough to have access to an Ethernet cable tester, which allowed us to verify that all of our cables were wired appropriately.
The cable tester looked for opens and shorts. If we had an open, that means that we miswired it from one side of the cable to the next when we were putting connectors on the ends.
We used the punch down tool to seat the wires into the patch connector and then verify that they were seated properly using continuity test.
For troubleshooting our sensors, the easiest way to troubleshoot a transmitter was just to take our phone and go down the length of the ramp, because our phones didn't have IR filters, so they could tell which ones were on and working and which ones weren't. We found a few transmitters that didn't seem to be turning on, so we swapped them out with ones that we knew were working. This is the easiest way for us to check whether it's the whole wiring that led up to the transmitter or if it was the transmitter itself. And we put the good ones in there and they were working, so it wasn't the wiring. It had to be the sensor. And then Tim did some troubleshooting on the sensor. What testing did you do?
Right. So I actually just took a sensor apart, and then since what I noticed was just a resistor and an LED, I went and used a diode function on our digital multimeter. In the case of this infrared LED, we don't see any visible light, but we do see that it has a forward voltage. This indicates that it's working appropriately. It's important to remember that diode check only works in one direction. If you can't get a reading, try turning your diode around. After I made sure that all of the transmitters were emitting infrared light, I went back and checked to make sure that all the receivers were functioning properly as well. So Jacqueline would be up at the computer, she had the Arduino, and each of the signals from each of those sensors was going to be read on the screen. So I went down and I broke the beam along the way and noticed if a sensor wasn't reporting a broken signal. So what we did then is take a digital multimeter, make sure that the sensor had power. If it didn't, we swapped in a known good working one. And then we also took a jumper in the case of some of them where we had like a bad ground or maybe a bad voltage source, and just jumpered it to a known working one because the wiring somewhere between the power supply and that sensor had a break in it.
I was doing troubleshooting from the top of the hill and I was looking at the code. We used the same program that we used for the encoders, but I added some troubleshooting lines in between. I added some extra print values and some delays to make sure that we could actually read what was going on. And the tip for writing troubleshooting code is you can comment it all out when you're done, and you can uncomment it whenever you need to use it.
Now let's talk about some general steps to use in troubleshooting your electronics projects. Before you turn it on, make sure that your sensors are plugged into the correct voltage source. Make sure that everything is connected. Make sure that your power is actually flipped on. And also check to make sure that you have voltage across your loads.
Verify that your circuit matches your wiring diagram and that all the analog components are plugged into analog pins and the digital ones into digital pins. And you can verify which direction your diodes are facing.
Remember to check for open circuits. If you're not getting a voltage across something, or maybe your wire is not getting the right signal, go ahead and grab that multimeter and check for continuity from point A to point B.
And if there's any issues with the resistance values that you're getting, you might have a short. So you can use the same function on your multimeter to verify that there's no connection between wires that are supposed to be isolated.
If you notice with your signal that you've got a floating voltage and you have a pull-up or pull-down resistor, make sure that your ground is bonded between your microcontroller, your Arduino, your power supply, and your sensor.
Thank you to Google's Making in Science team for making this video possible and all the videos in our Vector and Velocity series. If you want more science content like this, you can search hashtag sciencegoals. Thank you guys so much for exploring with us.
And we'll see you next time. Was there smoke?
No, but there was definitely a spark. That's how I knew it was broken.
I guess it emitted a photon.
Oh my.